Now, if a pastor, preacher, or evangelist has been truly planted of the Lord, then that same pastor, preacher, or evangelist is going to stand against any false gospel that will lead the sheep astray. If a pastor, preacher, or evangelist is telling you that the Roman Catholic Church is a legitimate Christian church, then they are surely not a planting of the Lord, and they've already been seduced by the doctrines of the devil himself. Don't ever forget that. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. Now keep in mind that the Apostle Paul wrote those words almost 2,000 years ago. This is written by a man, a Jewish man, who was in deception for many years himself. He had the scriptures, knew it inside out. He had that book, that Torah, that scroll. That's how they studied the Word of God, but the man was deceived. He did not know the Lord Jesus Christ. You could find out his testimony by reading the book of Acts. And in our day, folks, millions of so-called Protestant and evangelical Christians have been seduced because of the infiltration of the Roman Catholic Church into their churches. They have been so steamrolled by that false religious system that they rarely blink an eye anymore, and that's exactly the way the devil wants it. So people, you're going to answer to Almighty God one day, not them. So shake off those false prophets, those false pastors, preachers, and evangelists. Follow the Lord for yourself. As I said, search the scriptures for yourself. Do not fall for the lies of the ecumenical preachers and pastors who are joining hands with the Roman Catholic Church, because they will lead you into the same ditch that they've already fallen into themselves. So never forget that. Matthew chapter 15, verses 13 to 14. But he answered and said, every plant which my heavenly Father hath not planted shall be rooted up. Let them alone. They be blind leaders of the blind. And if the blind lead the blind, both shall fall into the ditch. You want to follow a man who's heading into a ditch? That's your choice. That's your privilege. But I advise you not take the word of God here. Take heed to what is being written, what is being spoken. Now, as I said, I'll get into the heart of the message right now. So I'm going to speak to you now three different anathemas or curses from the Roman Catholic Council of Trent. Now, these curses were upheld by the Council of Vatican II. You know, sometimes when you speak about Trent, you know, people think, well, that's old hat, that's something in the past. Oh no, you have people today that will defend that council. And they're very proud of it, by the way, Roman Catholic people. They defend the Council of Trent. That's why I'm quoting their own stuff here, folks. So these are anathemas against people who believe like me. I'm born again. I've been born again since the year 1989, ladies and gentlemen, saved by the power of the Holy Spirit. I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. I know that his blood has washed away my sins. So I came out of this false religious system known today as the Roman Catholic Church. Some people do not even like to refer to it as a church, and that's a good way to think. But I know that's the way you know it. I could call it sometimes a false religious system. Some people call it a cult, whatever. It applies, folks. It is not a legitimate Christian church. And as I, you know, keep in mind, folks, these are curses against me. And if you believe, if you don't believe what they teach here, I'm going to show you that you are under one of their curses. Okay, actually, I'm going to give you three. You're under every one. If you are truly born again of the Spirit and you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, you know that he finished the work on the cross, then every one of the curses that I'm about to read, you're under that curse, folks. So I want to show you the insanity of joining hands with such a system. Keep in mind, you're under one of their curses, so it is not possible to have unity with such a system. Okay, so I want you to know these are from the Council of Trent, upheld by Vatican II, which took place back in 64 1964 and 1965. So I'm going to read these and listen carefully, folks. Take the time to listen carefully. The first one I'm going to give to you from the Council of Trent, the 13th session, canons on the most holy sacrament of the Eucharist. Okay, that's their, what I call the cookie wafer, the piece of bread. And this is canon one. If anyone denieth that in the sacrament of the most holy Eucharist are contained truly, really, and substantially the body and blood together with the soul and divinity of our Lord Jesus Christ, and consequently the whole Christ, but say that he's only therein as in a sign or in a figure or virtue, let him be anathema or let him be accursed. So there's the first one. So what they're saying, if you do not believe that, you know, when the Roman Catholic Mass takes place, they do what's known as transubstantiation. And they believe when that Roman Catholic priest comes in and at the time of the consecration of the Mass, transubstantiation, that bread is turned into the body and blood. Holy. That's Jesus Christ. That's what they believe. And if you don't believe that, they say, let you be anathema, let you be accursed. Now, I want you to know something, folks, that the martyrs, people who are killed, lay down their lives. This is one of the main things that they fought against. They refused to believe the teachings of Rome. They said, no, this is only a symbol. They do not believe that Jesus Christ is in that host, in that wafer, in that cookie wafer. And what did they do? They put people to death, some say by the millions. We don't know. It's all covered up, folks. Hear me now. You know that. By the millions, I believe. People were murdered. They were martyred for fighting against that system. So if you don't believe that, folks, you are under a Roman Catholic curse. Now, I believe that this teaching is one of the most demonic things that has ever been taught by man. It's an absolute insult to the perfect and finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross, because he has conquered sin and death. Now, the idea of bringing the risen and ascended Jesus Christ back down onto Roman Catholic altars is absolutely ludicrous and absolutely sinful. Every Catholic priest needs to repent and get saved in the true biblical way. Absolutely incredible, folks, what we're talking about here. The Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 18, for Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened or made alive by the Spirit. So if you're a true believer, you've been born again of the Spirit, you know that Jesus Christ paid the price in full. You are already under one of these curses. I bring that to you today. So if you want to join in unity with a system that says you're under a curse, well, that is your choice for sure. Now, the second one I'll give you, Council of Trent, 13th session, canons on the most holy sacrament of the Eucharist, canon number 5. Here it is. If anyone saith either that the principal fruit of the most holy Eucharist is the remission of sins, or that other effects do not result therefrom, let him be anathema or accursed. So if you don't believe, folks, that the principal fruit of the most holy Eucharist, I call it the cookie wafer, is the remission of sins, then you are under the curse of the Roman Catholic Church. So what are they teaching there? That Catholic host, that's what they call it, the Roman Catholic host, if you don't believe that your sins can be forgiven by what takes place there at that Mass with this Eucharist, then let you be accursed. That's incredible, folks. Absolutely incredible. Now, I do not believe that the Most Holy Eucharist has any power at all to forgive my sins any more than I believe in Santa Claus or the Easter Bunny. In fact, I left the Roman Catholic Church after my sins were forgiven by the Lord Jesus Christ himself. I did not need a middleman. I don't need a Roman Catholic priest. I did not need to go through Mary to get to Jesus Christ either. I made a direct connection to Jesus Christ through faith, and he saved my soul just like he promised he would. He promised me everlasting life, and I took him at His word. Glory to God. John 3:16-18. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. He that believeth on Him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Glory to God. How dare the Roman Catholic Church tell anybody that they need the Catholic Mass to satisfy the justice of God for their own sins? Do they really teach that stuff, folks? Yes. In fact, that's one of the very purposes of the Mass that is listed, and it's found in the Roman Catholic Catechism. Look on your screen. There it is right there. Incredible. One of the purposes of the Roman Catholic Mass is to satisfy the justice of God for sins committed against Him. That in itself makes the Roman Catholic gospel a false gospel, and that in itself puts a curse upon that gospel. You can find that curse in Galatians 1:8-9, where Paul said, but though we are an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel unto you other than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. Oh, folks, we're talking very, very serious stuff here. As you see this modern day false unity taking place, with very few people even opening their mouth to say a word. They join hands. People know even that what I'm saying is true, but they just remain silent, which is even worse, folks. So this modern day unity with the Roman Catholic Church is nothing more than a religious sham, and that's the work of the devil himself. People have been hoodwinked by the Christian leaders working hand in hand with the Roman Catholic Church by telling them that they basically believe the same things. We just have some minor differences. We both share the Apostles' Creed. Hear me now. Your soul is being deceived, folks. If you're joining hands with this system that declares a false gospel, it's going to get worse. Hear me now, folks. It is going to get worse. It's time for you, even as a Christian. You don't have to be a pastor or a leader in your church. It's time for you as a Christian, as an individual Christian, to speak up, tell your friends, because we have no idea where this whole thing is going to end, folks, or how deep this thing is going to go and how quick. But we can make a difference if we speak out. So the Roman Catholic Church, they still offer Roman Catholic Masses with this Eucharist that I'm speaking about today for dead people in purgatory. Did you know that they have that teaching in purgatory to this day? That they believe there are souls that they can have Masses said for by Roman Catholic priests to shorten their time in purgatory. Do not let anybody tell you they do not teach that anymore, folks. To this day, you can walk into a funeral parlor and you will see people walking in that door with Mass cards. I did it as a Roman Catholic many times. People walk in with a Mass card. They make a donation at their local church, their local rectory, and they're going to come in with that Mass card where it's promising that priests are going to say Masses for the dead person, for the person inside that casket. Now hear me, that person is either with the Lord or their soul has been damned. Jesus preached that. He says you're either saved or you're damned, folks. When He rose from the dead, you can find that in Mark 16. Preach the gospel, folks. It's either heaven or hell. There's no in-between place. There is no such place as purgatory. So this is also part of this teaching here, that Roman Catholic Mass, that Eucharist being said for dead people as well as for living people. So does that sound like the gospel that was preached by the Lord and His disciples? Absolutely not. Of course not. The truth of the matter is, folks, is that salvation has been paid for in full by the Lord Jesus Christ, and anyone can go directly to the Lord by faith and get saved instantly. The Apostle Paul was a murderer of true Christians, and yet the Lord still saved that man's soul. He told the real truth on how a person can be justified before God. Here it is, Romans 5:6-9. For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commended his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. If you're a Roman Catholic, hear me today, folks. Hear me today. You can be saved right now wherever you are. You might be home, sitting in your kitchen, your living room, your bedroom. Hear me now. You can call upon the Lord, ask him to save your soul. Tell him you're a sinner, you need his mercy. Ask him to save you. Ask him to fill you with the Holy Spirit. He said you must be born again. You do not have to go to another mass. You do not have to go to mass day in, day out, or even weekly. You can be saved by calling upon the Lord right now. I'm telling you, no matter what your past, this is true salvation I'm preaching to you today, folks. And you're hearing it from a former Roman Catholic. How dare any Roman Catholic priest tell me or anyone else that they need a Roman Catholic Mass to satisfy the justice of God, which Christ already satisfied on the cross. That's like telling a man he needs to make perpetual payments on his home that he knows he paid off a long time ago. He has the receipt in his drawer or his safety deposit box at home, paid in full to prove that he's free from that debt. True Christians know that the sin debt has been paid in full at the cross. How? The Bible tells us so. I just read it to you. We can be justified by the blood of Jesus Christ. He died for the ungodly. You heard it. It's in the Word of God. Folks, believe it. It's that simple. Okay, curse number three. The Council of Trent 13, the session, canons on the most holy sacrament of the Eucharist, canon number 6. If anyone saith that in the holy sacrament of the Eucharist, Christ, the only begotten Son of God, is not to be adored with the worship, even external of latria, and is consequently neither to be venerated with a special festive solemnity, nor to be solemnly borne about in processions according to the laudable and universal rite and custom of Holy Church, or is not to be proposed publicly to the people to be adored, and that the adorers thereof are idolaters, let him be anathema, or let him be accursed. Now, what is this curse speaking about, folks? Perhaps you've seen this take place yourself. I know I have. I have participated within the church where they would walk from one part of the church down to the basement or whatever. I've seen it in front of the church. They're carrying what's known as a monstrance, and that monstrance is big. It's almost like a sunburst, and in the middle is a circle, and that circle you'll find the Roman Catholic host with a cookie wafer, and the priest is holding it. I would see him have it wrapped in some type of vestment type cloth, gold colored or something, and he's holding it straight up, and an altar boy's holding candles, all sorts of things, and it's a procession. This is what this is speaking about, and it's done publicly. They believe that Jesus Christ is in that cookie wafer, folks, and that he's to be worshipped, and that he's to be adored. And if you refuse to believe that, if you would call them idolaters for doing that, and that's what I call them, I was an idolater myself, did the same things. The word says here in their tradition, in this curse, let you be accursed. If you say that that should not be adored, you're under a curse. Now, folks, if you're a true Christian, and you have no problem with that, then I would call you a Roman Catholic yourself. I don't know what else to say. So that's what we're dealing with there. So you have heard three curses. Now, obviously, I don't believe that the Roman Catholic Eucharist is to be worshipped either publicly or privately. It's idolatry, folks. That cookie wafer, that it's nothing more than a cookie wafer. It is not Jesus Christ at all. I do not believe that a Roman Catholic priest has any power to change that cookie wafer into Jesus Christ any more than they can change the moon into a piece of solid 24 karat gold. Now, I believe that those who worship that cookie wafer in that way, they absolutely are idolaters. They need to repent of that idolatry. And you know, while I'm on the topic of idolatry, folks, the Roman Catholic system is filled, absolutely filled with idols. And many people do not understand or realize that the Roman Catholic church, they removed the second commandment that dealt with those things, those statues, better known as graven images, okay? They removed that commandment out of the catechism. Growing up, when I read the catechism, I never knew this commandment because it was not there. They have as their second commandment, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. That's what they have listed. It's not the second commandment at all. I'm going to read to you the second commandment, then you'll understand why that whole church is walking, folks. It is walking with absolute, demon powers. They're walking with statues, folks. Here it is, Exodus chapter 20, verses 4 to 6. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them, for I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children, unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. So you say, wait a second, how can this be? If they took the second commandment out, that would leave only nine. Well, here's what they did. You want to talk about craftiness, folks? I mean, this is unbelievable. Think about that. They're tampering with the Word of God, and people have no problem with this. Okay, so they took the second one out. Here's what they did. They took the 10th commandment that dealt with covetousness, and you can find that in Exodus chapter 20 and 17. That one verse dealt with covetousness, and they chopped it in half and made two commandments out of that, dealing with coveting your neighbor's goods and coveting your neighbor's wife. So they made 9 and 10 out of one that should have just been the 10th commandment. So what they did now, and they took the rest and moved them up. Unbelievable stuff what this church will do, this wicked religious system will do, folks. So now we have, as the second commandment, where there should have been absolute warnings about idolatry, it's not there anymore. So it just says, don't take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. And that's what happened. And you just heard the real second commandment. Perhaps you might have been listening to that and heard it for the first time. So if you're into this idol worship, these statues of Mary, which I was all set to go buy a statue myself, and right before I got saved, folks, when I was born again of the Spirit. Thank God the Lord saved me money. Hallelujah. So this idolatry, folks, and if you go and check out the prices of some of these statues, I'm talking hundreds upon hundreds of dollars you can spend on these statues, depending upon the material that it's made out of, and all different colors, and you can get them basically anywhere, and people will bow down before them, they will pray to them, they will carry them where they go, whether it be, and then you can go into scapulars, you can get into all sorts of stuff, but while I'm on this topic, even that little host, folks, that little cookie wafer, right there during the mass, that people will bow down before that cookie wafer. Oh, yes, they will. I was an altar boy, folks. I know what I'm talking about. And you will have the priest, they have a little tabernacle with a little curtain around it, and he pull a string, and it opens the curtain, and then he has a key. He'd open up that little, I could still hear that lock turning, a very distinct turn, a click, when that thing is opened and closed. And what they do during each mass, you'd be inside the sacristy, and they would have a bag of those cookie wafers. I mean, hundreds of them in a bag. And a priest would come in, you'd wait till he came, and he would take as many as he thought he needed for that mass, okay? If it was a daily mass, he really wouldn't take a whole lot of them. A Sunday mass, they would take even more, obviously, because the place was packed. So he would take those little circles, those cookies, the cookie wafers, put them in a chalice and do that whole thing. And then when you go out to do the mass, there's going to be a time where they're going to consecrate those hosts, transubstantiation. They believe now that that becomes Jesus Christ, folks. And when they receive the Eucharist at the time of communion, the priest would say, the body of Christ. And that's what happens. And you say, amen. And they take that thing in their mouth or in their hand. Now they made some changes. And as an altar boy, I'm talking back in the 60s, you'd hold this little round thing made out of brass called a patent so that the host would not fall on the floor. And we had altar boy stories. We used to talk back and forth, hearing stories about once a host fell on the floor and turned into blood. Oh, you were afraid that you would miss it. It's really something, folks. This bondage of the Roman Catholic system. So anyway, at the end of the Mass, whatever was left over, there'd be several hosts of those cookie wafers left over. The priest would then take those, okay, and put them back, and he'd put them in that tabernacle because now they were consecrated hosts. They believe that's Jesus Christ, folks. Oh, yes. So this is part of the bondage of that system, folks. And that's why I'm speaking. So it's important that you know that there are more than 100 anathemas, similar to what I just read to you, curses against people like myself, known as heretics in their sight. They might call us separated brethren in the modern day, folks, but I'm here to tell you, folks, what's going on, this false unity, it's a counter-reformation. That's what it is. And the man and woman of God better start speaking up before this thing gets any worse. The Romish teachings, the teachings of Rome, they do not stand the test of Scripture today, and they will not stand the test of Scripture on Judgment Day. I'm telling you today, folks, I pity the pastors, the preachers, the evangelists who somehow think that this false unity that's going on is of God, because it's not. God will never join hands asking his people to join hands with a system that preaches a false gospel. I pity even more those true Christian leaders who know the truth that I'm speaking today. They're listening today, they know I'm speaking the truth, but they remain silent rather than lose their popularity. That's what it is. Many of these people, they are compromises. They remain silent. Why? Because they're working hand in hand with many of the grossest compromises, and they don't want to lose their friendship. They do not want to lose their support. I'm telling you right now, folks, that's why they remain silent. And hear me, it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. So let me end it here, folks. Mark 13, 21 to 23, and then, if any man shall say to you, lo, here is Christ, or lo, he is there, believe him not. For false Christs and false prophets shall rise and shall show signs and wonders to seduce, if it were possible, even the elect. But take ye heed, behold, I have foretold you all things. Luke 6 and 26, woe unto you when all men shall speak well of you, for so did their fathers to the false prophets. And I don't know, I think I read this already, but I'm going to read it again, a very important scripture, 1 Timothy 4:1. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. You heard the word of God. Go forth here today, folks. I have given you three separate anathemas, curses from the Roman Catholic system. This is their official doctrine today in the year 2015. This is not something from the past. Council of Trent, upheld by Vatican II. And as you watch this false unity go on, and you know you're sitting in a congregation that unifies with Rome and promotes ecumenical meetings, or perhaps some of your favorite teachers are preaching that it's okay. Hear me now. You've been warned. You've been warned here with this message. And I encourage you to take heed. Think of all the Roman Catholic people out there by the millions, folks. Many of your family members, your mothers, your fathers, brothers, sisters, cousins, co-workers, you know. Especially if you are one of those who has been set free from that system yourself, you do have a responsibility. Don't hold back the truth, folks. We're talking eternity, we're talking heaven, and we're talking hell. Not a light thing. Not a light thing. And I'm going to leave it right there. Be blessed in the Lord Jesus Christ.
And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels, and prevailed not. Neither was their place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him.
Even though the devil was cast out of heaven, he continued his warfare against Christ and God on this earth. For nearly 6,000 years, this conflict has ebbed and flowed. But the final battle to be waged in this great controversy, the point to which all events have been heading, is what the Bible describes as the great day of God Almighty, the Battle of Armageddon. This final battle between truth and error is clearly portrayed in Revelation chapters 12, 13, 14, and 18. And all humanity has entered into this battle today. And since Armageddon is a symbol describing the spiritual battle between truth and error, what are the weapons the devil uses in this great conflict?
And I saw three unclean spirits like frogs come out of the mouth of the dragon and out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet.
So here we have three unclean spirits like frogs. When we look at the plagues of Egypt, we see frogs in their plagues, and there are a lot of parallels that we see here. The real danger with frogs are their tongues, and out of their mouth come words that sound like statements of belief. These three entities, the dragon, the beast, and the false prophet, catch their prey by speaking or teaching various doctrines of error. And since Armageddon is a symbol describing this spiritual battle between truth and error, the weapons the devil uses in this great conflict are things likened to frogs, which come out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. For those who desire to follow Christ and the truth, it is of the utmost importance that we clearly identify who the dragon, the beast power, and the false prophet are, so that we can avoid being deceived by their various false doctrines and thereby lost. As is revealed in Revelation 12, the dragon is primarily Satan. All lies, deceptions, erroneous beliefs and false doctrines which have originated out of his mouth, such as various spiritualistic, paganistic and occultic teachings which many kingdoms of the world have been established upon, including the ancient pagan Roman Empire. While many believe paganism to be a thing of the past, there are still millions today who are involved in its heathenistic beliefs and devil worship. The primary feature of the pagan religion is the worship of nature. Since the most exalted form in nature is the human body, and most particularly the mind, man is led to worship the powers of the mind, and thus to exalt human opinion above divine revelation. All of the great ruling powers of earth have also demonstrated the fact that in paganism, church and state were not separate, but were united together. In Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece and Rome, the state was always used to support and give force to the pagan religion of the time. Time and again laws were enacted and civil powers were used to enforce the worship of pagan deities and false beliefs. Today, as well as in ancient times, the spirit of exalting and worshipping human opinions, institutions and tradition, the spirit of worldliness and the craving to unite the church with the state in order that the church might be strengthened to enforce her dogma and decrees, is the spirit of the dragon. And this spirit will grow more and more prominent until it culminates in the great time of trouble for God's people. It is not only this unclean spirit that is working today through humanism and other vain philosophies, exalting the human above the divine, exalting error above the truth. But there is a second unclean spirit which comes out of the mouth of the beast. In Revelation 13, the beast which arose out of the ruins of pagan Rome, the beast which united herself with paganism in order to increase her numbers, the beast which ruled for 1,260 prophetic days, or 3.5 prophetic years, or 42 prophetic months, each totaling 1,260 literal years, using the day-for-year principle found in Numbers 14:34 and in Ezekiel, is none other than the Roman Catholic Church. This great religious system of Catholicism exalts the organized church above the individual conscience, and when there is a conflict between the Bible and church creed, the latter always assumes predominance over the Bible truth. If there is a disagreement between a person's conscience and church dogma, the church, through its traditions and opinions, always takes preeminence. In contrast with this denomination by church rule, Paul commends the noble Bereans.
These were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind, and searched the scriptures daily, whether those things were so.
Nowhere do we see Paul asking the believers to accept doctrine on the basis of apostolic authority, but rather he commended them for searching the scriptures for themselves to confirm the truth of what they had been taught. The idea of God's word as the supreme authority and rule of life is the religion and truth of the Bible. It is this knowledge that sets us free.
Search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. All scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. To the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free.
The third unclean spirit is the spirit of the false prophet. A prophet is one who claims to have received messages from God, and then claims to be God's spokesman in relaying these messages to the people.
And he said, Hear now my words. If there be a prophet among you, I, the Lord, will make myself known unto him in a vision, and will speak unto him in a dream. When a prophet speaketh in the name of the Lord, if the thing follow not, nor come to pass, that is the thing which the Lord hath not spoken, but the prophet hath spoken it presumptuously. Thou shalt not be afraid of him.
A false prophet, then, would be someone who purports to be speaking for God, when in reality he is not.
Then the Lord said unto me, The prophets prophesy lies in my name. I sent them not, neither have I commanded them, neither spake unto them. They prophesy unto you a false vision and divination, and a thing of naught, and the deceit of their heart.
The false prophet cannot refer to the papacy, for it has always claimed to accept tradition above Bible revelation, and the right to change God's commandments at will. But the various churches of Protestantism have professed to follow the Bible and the Bible alone as the basis of their faith and doctrine. Yet we see them following in the footsteps of Rome by exhorting tradition and human opinion above the truth of God's word. They are therefore a false prophet, clinging to and speaking forth error, and yet claiming it is God's truth. While differing in some aspects, Protestant churches are all uniting together on points of doctrine which they all agree, and are more and more resembling Roman Catholicism. When in the pursuit of her desired goals, this false prophet of Protestantism follows in the same footsteps of Rome by uniting with and resorting to civil power to support its teachings and trample upon the right of free conscience in order to enforce her dogmas. She will also become an image of this beast found in Revelation 13. By rejecting truth, people are rejecting the author of truth and preparing themselves to take the devil's side in this last great conflict. By persistent refusal to accept the authority of God, the lawgiver, and to obey his laws, men, women, and children are binding themselves to the great apostate in lawlessness. But on the opposite side to all of this, we see God's messages. These are symbolized by angels flying in the midst of heaven. The devil's messages come from frogs and reptiles. They are messages which deceive people with their false words. Just as when the devil beguiled Eve, it was with words. The scripture says it comes out of the mouth of the dragon and out of the mouth of the beast and out of the mouth of the false prophet. So let's look at Revelation 16 again.
And I saw three unclean spirits like frogs come out of the mouth of the dragon and out of the mouth of the beast and out of the mouth of the false prophet. For they are the spirits of devils working miracles which go forth unto the kings of the earth and of the whole world to gather them to the battle of that great day of God Almighty.
These are some very important verses to consider. Speaking of the beast's power,
and he doth great wonders, so that he maketh fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men, and deceiveth them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast.
Lying wonders and counterfeit miracles. And that's why our faith has to be rooted in what the Bible says and not in any great miracles that has happened. We must not be deceived when we hear on the news that miracles are happening all over the world, or that some counterfeit Christ appears performing wonders, maybe even bringing fire down from heaven, like Elijah when he prayed and fire came down. Because there will be many signs and wonders in the last days, and that's why we must know the word of God and go by what the Bible says alone. It goes on to say in Revelation 16:14,
to gather them to the battle of that great day of God Almighty.
The scriptures declare that the spirits of devils will work mighty miracles that deceive almost the whole world and then gather the people together for the last great battle. The focal point of the conflict will be the law of God, particularly the Sabbath, which points to the lawgiver as the only creator and hence to our inherent obligation as his creatures to render him obedience. It is the work of the three angels' messages of Revelation 14, 6-12, and 18, 1-5, to counter this attack on God's law by presenting to the world the worship due to God as our Creator.
And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, fear God, and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come. And worship him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of waters. And there followed another angel, saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast and his image, and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up for ever and ever. And they have no rest day nor night, who worship the beast and his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. And after these things I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power. And the earth was lightened with his glory. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and is become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. And I heard another voice from heaven, saying, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues. For her sins have reached unto heaven, and God hath remembered her iniquities.
Each person will have to make their choice, and this choice will seal their destiny. Will you follow God and his law leading to peace and happiness? Or will you follow the beast power driven by Satan to destruction? With the threefold union of the dragon, the beast and the false prophet, all the people of the earth will be forced to unite on the platform of error against God and the truth of the Bible, and those who do not follow their decrees will be killed. Thus, the deceptive doctrines and teachings of this threefold union of spiritualism, Catholicism and Protestantism, all the inhabitants of the earth will be brought to decide for or against God and his truth. Out of the mouth of the dragon comes spiritualism. Out of the mouth of the beast, Catholicism. And out of the mouth of the false prophet, apostate Protestantism. Three different teachings that these three communions agree on, and these will bring the whole world together to battle on the great day of God Almighty.
And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And he causeth all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads, and that no man might buy or sell, save he that had the mark, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name.
The time is fast approaching. This test will come to every living person. All who have complied to worldly demands and conformed to worldly customs, instead of following God and his word, will find themselves going along with the powers that be, rather than subject themselves to ridicule, insult, threatened imprisonment and death. This battle is between God and Satan, the commandments of God or the commandments of men. God never forces the will or the conscience, but Satan constantly resorts to varying degrees of force and cruelty in order to gain the control of those whom he cannot otherwise seduce. Through fear or by actual force, Satan endeavours to rule the conscience and to secure homage to himself. To accomplish this, he works with both religious and secular authorities, moving them to enact and enforce human laws which defy God and his law. Once again, as in Daniel's day, an image will be raised, much as was the golden image upon the plain of Shinar in Daniel 3. The issue is the same, the law and honour of God. And just as the music and imposing display worked to secure support for Nebuchadnezzar and his image in ancient Babylon, so in this final conflict there will be false doctrines and miracles to deceive. Anciently, when all lesser inducements failed, there was a fiery furnace waiting to persuade the conscience. In a similar manner, the commandment-keeping people of God face the loss of all worldly support and ultimately death itself as the price for their faithfulness to God and his law. Only those whose faith is founded upon the sure word of God will be able to stand amid the near total apostasy.
And at that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people. And there shall be a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time. And at that time thy people shall be delivered, every one that shall be found written in the book.
At this darkest point in earth's history, when in the final stages of this battle of Armageddon, and it appears that the forces of evil must surely prevail and God's obedient remnant people must soon seal their testimony with their blood, God's followers will be delivered and all the workers of iniquity will be destroyed. Christ himself comes to save his obedient and faithful followers and take them home. Armageddon, the battle of the great day of God Almighty, is also referred to as the day of the Lord, the day of days. A type of that day of judgment is found in Joel.
I will also gather all nations, and will bring them down into the valley of Jehoshaphat, and will plead with them there for my people and for my heritage Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations, and parted my land.
Now you have to know your Bible. You see, there was a great battle in the days of Jehoshaphat. You can find this story in 2 Chronicles 20. All the nations around about him came to attack. There were the Edomites, the Moabites, the Ammonites. It looked hopeless. He didn't know what to do, so he prayed, and God sent him a prophet. The prophet said to him, "Don't be afraid, trust in the Lord." They then sent the Levites out before them singing. They were also told to dig ditches, and when the sun came up, the enemy saw the ditches and thought it was blood. They got scared somehow, and they went into battle and started to fight amongst themselves, and the enemy self-destructed. They turned on one another, and Jehoshaphat didn't even have to fire an arrow. God delivered them. So when it talks about the Valley of Jehoshaphat, don't go looking at the map to find out where the Battle of Armageddon is going to be. It's talking about what happened in the days of Jehoshaphat. It's talking about what's going to happen. Again, it's not a place on a map. It is a great battle in the last days between Christ and Satan. And that's what this battle in Revelation is talking about. It's not a literal battle that is going to take place in a valley somewhere over in Israel. It's not about Iran, Pakistan or India. It's talking about the great controversy that has been taking place since Satan rebelled. The great controversy of those who follow God and those who follow Satan, the devil. When we study the scriptures, we find that heaven is located in the north of our universe. What is meant by the sides of the north? Well, the answer is found in Psalm 48.
Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, in the city of our God, in the mountain of his holiness. Beautiful for situation, the joy of the whole earth, is Mount Zion, on the sides of the north, the city of the great King.
Satan's sin was pride and rebellion against God. Satan wanted to put himself in the place of God. As he said, I will be like the Most High. Satan's desire is to be equal to God. The issue is that of a throne. Who is going to rule? This throne is the one that is over the universe. A throne represents a position of rule and authority. Satan wants to have a position of rule and authority. He wants to be the ruler and governor of the universe. In his rebellion, when he tried to overthrow God, God spoke of this void in the north.
How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which did weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High.
Now when they would offer the sacrifices in the Old Testament, they would offer them northward toward the Lord. Notice what Moses said in Leviticus.
And he shall kill it on the side of the altar northward before the Lord. And the priests, Aaron's sons, shall sprinkle his blood round about upon the altar.
Northward before the Lord. The implication is clear that the Lord is in the north. North is always the same direction from this planet, no matter what time of day. If you were to point to the north in the morning, 12 hours later, you would still be pointing in the same direction. No matter where the Earth is in its orbit about the Sun, north is always the same direction in relationship to the Earth. So no matter what time of day or what time of year, north is always the same direction. The Bible also implies that salvation comes from the north.
For promotion cometh neither from the east, nor from the west, nor from the south.
Other translations render promotion as exhorting, lifting up. So we can conclude that promotion, authority to reward someone, to exhort and lift them up, only comes from the north, since it is the only choice left. So God and heaven must be located in the north of our universe. Armageddon is the final mobilization of the powers of the world to exterminate God's people, like they did with Jehoshaphat. But when that time comes, although it looks hopeless, God fights for his people.
And he gathered them together into a place called in the Hebrew tongue Armageddon.
Writing on the Isle of Patmos, you have John, who is Jewish. He is now an old man and mostly speaks Aramaic. He's imprisoned by the Romans in a Latin country on a Greek island. And when he wrote about Armageddon, the best scholars can figure is that it has something to do with the Valley of Megiddo. You have the word Har, which means hill or mountain. This phrase confuses people, and everyone tries to point on a map where this hill or mountain is, the place where they will gather for the great battle of Armageddon. Curiously, no place on earth bears the name of Armageddon, and this passage in Revelation is the only mention of it in Scripture. The Greek is most commonly thought to be a translation of the Hebrew Har-Megiddo, literally Mountain of Megiddo. Here is what Strong's has to say about the word.
Armageddon, or Har-Megiddon, a symbol or name, Armageddon.
Strong's proposes that the Greek word Armageddon originates from the two following Hebrew words.
Har, a mountain or range of hills, sometimes used figuratively, hill or hill country, mount or mountain, promotion. Megiddon, or Megiddo, rendezvous, Megiddon or Megiddo, a place in Palestine, Megiddo, Megiddon.
The mountain Megiddo is located in the plain of Esdraelon or Jezreel, a valley 14 by 20 miles in size, located to the southwest of Nazareth. Here it is thought by many a great final battle will be fought at the end of time. But there is another possible Hebrew origin for the word Armageddon that is less well known. The clue is in the book of Isaiah.
How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which did weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High.
The phrase mount of the congregation in the Hebrew is Har Moed. The word Har again means mountain, and Moed is a place of appointed times, assembly of the congregation. Strong's defines it as follows.
Moed, Moed, or Moed Moed, Moada, Moador, an appointment, a fixed time or season, a festival, conventionally a year, by implication an assembly, as convened for a definite purpose. Technically the congregation, by extension the place of meeting, also a signal, as appointed beforehand, appointed sign or time, place of solemn assembly, congregation, set or solemn feast, appointed or due season, solemn or solemnity, synagogue, a set time or time appointed.
A parallel is apparent here between the gathering at Armageddon and Satan claiming that he will assume authority on the mount of the congregation and be like the Most High. The word Moed is commonly used to describe the travelling Hebrew tabernacle. Here are examples of where the word translated as congregation is Moed.
In the tabernacle of the congregation, without the veil, which is before the testimony, Aaron and his sons shall order it from evening to morning before the Lord. It shall be a statute for ever unto their generations on the behalf of the children of Israel. And Moses took the tabernacle and pitched it without the camp, afar off from the camp, and called it the tabernacle of the congregation.
Note that Satan also claimed in Isaiah that he would sit upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. This is a reference to Mount Moriah, the site of the temple of God in Jerusalem, which was just north to the city of David. The temple was the final location of the tabernacle of the congregation, the place of the appointed times, where the people of Israel assembled on God's appointed times or Sabbath festivals to worship and sacrifice to the Lord. Now, interestingly enough, in George Wigram's Englishman's Hebrew and Chaldee Concordance of the Old Testament of 1874, the word Moed is spelled and pronounced a little differently. He shows it as Mogehed. Mount of the congregation in Isaiah 14:13 would then be Har Moged. So the controversy between God and Satan, the Battle of Armageddon, is over who will have authority over the mount of the congregation, the Har Moged, the place of appointed times and seasons for the people of God. Satan stated his goal in Isaiah 14:13. God's throne is on the Mount of the Congregation, and Satan wants to gain control and be like God. The little horn of Daniel, the Antichrist, is prophesied to attempt the same goal.
And he shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws. And they shall be given into his hand until a time and times and the dividing of time.
In context, the times and laws the little horn would think to change are the times and laws of God. This is referring to the Moed, the appointed times of God, as related to the Mount of the Congregation and the Temple of God. This would indicate that the Battle of Armageddon is not the location of a physical battle near Megiddo. Rather, it is the focus or reason behind the spiritual battle between God and Satan, that being a conflict over the authority to appoint holy times of congregation. We have seen that many names in the Book of Revelation are spiritual and symbolic. We have looked at the story of Jehoshaphat and how God saved him from the evil of the surrounding nations. Now let's look at three more stories in the Bible, which may help us to understand what the real battle of Armageddon is about, this battle between good and evil. In Judges 4 and 5, we see that the children of Israel had wandered from God and were oppressed for 20 years by the Canaanites, a pagan country. And finally God raised up a prophetess named Deborah. Deborah called to Barak to gather all the people together at Mount Tabor, and they there fought with a general named Sisera. He had 900 iron chariots and a massive army. There was no way the Israelites could fight them. They had been oppressed for years. All they had to fight with was garden shovels and pruning hooks. Deborah told Barak that God would be with them. He said he would go forward if she would go with them. She said that she would, but also said to him that you will not get the credit. The credit will go to a woman. Well, not only did the credit go to the woman Deborah, but also to another woman named Jael. Because when the Israelites took on the Canaanites in the Valley of Megiddo, the Canaanites were conquered. Their chariots got stuck in the mire, it had evidently rained, and Sisera fled. He found a tent of the Canaanites, which were a sort of neutral people, and he asked a woman there, Jael, if she would show him sanctuary, hide him. So Sisera hides under a rug, and while he slept, she drove a tent peg through his temple with a mallet, her blow being so forceful that the peg pinned his head to the ground. So she too got credit for destroying the army of the Canaanites. Then Deborah sings a prophetic song about the victory they receive.
The kings came and fought. Then fought the kings of Canaan in Taanach by the waters of Megiddo. They took no gain of money. They fought from heaven. The stars in their courses fought against Sisera.
Here she says the heavens fought for us. We did not have to fight. The heavens fought for them and they were delivered. Then you have the story of Gideon. Now this is especially interesting when you study the word Armageddon, because Gideon's name is very similar. Gideon and his men were completely outnumbered. This was another battle in the Valley of Megiddo. You can read in Judges chapter 7 the story of Gideon. Now in the original Hebrew, several times God spoke to Gideon, and as we can see from this slide, it's very similar to the word Armageddon. Now in the story of Gideon, you have the same thing that you have in Revelation. There was a threefold power. You had the Midianites, the Amalekites, and the people of the east, all gathered against God's people, and they oppressed them. Now all Gideon had was 300 men against all these. He divided them into three companies, and they were each given three things: a pitcher, a trumpet, and a sword. All these are symbols of the word of God. Let your light shine. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. And the word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword. At the right moment, they broke the pitcher, the light shone forth, they blew the trumpet, waved their sword, and shouted. The enemy woke up in disarray, confounded and confused by the noise of the blaring trumpets and the light shining all around the hill. They thought there was a vast army, and they all turned on each other and self-destructed. This is what happens at the end of time. God fights for us from heaven in the battle of Armageddon. The Bible tells us of Christ's coming. This is the seventh plague.
And he gathered them together into a place called in the Hebrew tongue Armageddon. And the seventh angel poured out his vial into the air, and there came a great voice out of the temple of heaven from the throne, saying, "It is done." And there were voices and thunders and lightnings, and there was a great earthquake, such as was not since men were upon the earth, so mighty an earthquake and so great.
The final story that illustrates what the Battle of Armageddon is about is of a favourite young king in his 30s, about the age of Christ when he started his ministry. His name was Josiah. He died in the Valley of Megiddo, defending God's people. So the Valley of Megiddo, to an Israelite, talks about a king they loved, who gave his life, who sacrificed himself. Again, the Valley of Megiddo talks about battles that are won when God fought for his people in miraculous ways. Let's read again from Joel 3, where it talks about the Valley of Jehoshaphat.
I will also gather all nations, and will bring them down into the Valley of Jehoshaphat, and will plead with them there for my people and for my heritage Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations and parted my land. Let the heathen be weakened and come up to the Valley of Jehoshaphat, for there will I sit to judge all the heathen round about.
Here we see God gathering all to the Valley of Jehoshaphat, and just like the stories we have read where only God can rescue his people from a hopeless situation, so the same will happen in Armageddon. When the situation looks hopeless and God's people are about to be destroyed, at the last minute God fights for us. You see, at the end of time, all the forces of the world are going to be gathered together against those who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus.
And the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ.
This is the Battle of Armageddon, and just as the world gets ready to launch the battle against God's people at the end of time, Jesus will come in all his glory.
And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations. And the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bondman, and every freeman, hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains, and said to the mountains and rocks, Fall on us, and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand?
Then the final seventh plague.
And he gathered them together into a place called in the Hebrew tongue Armageddon. And the seventh angel poured out his vial into the air, and there came a great voice out of the temple of heaven from the throne, saying, It is done. And there were voices and thunders and lightnings, and there was a great earthquake, such as was not since men were upon the earth, so mighty an earthquake and so great.
It is done. This is what Jesus said on the cross, but this time it is speaking about the final judgment. Probation has now closed on all mankind.
And the great city was divided into three parts, and the cities of the nations fell, and great Babylon came in remembrance before God, to give unto her the cup of the wine of the fierceness of his wrath. And every island fled away, and the mountains were not found. And there fell upon men a great hail out of heaven, every stone about the weight of a talent. And men blasphemed God because of the plague of the hail, for the plague thereof was exceeding great.
This all happens at the time that Jesus comes to take his faithful people home. They will be caught up to meet him in the air. And this is another sign that we can know that anyone claiming to be Christ, no matter how good they look or how many miracles they do, cannot be Christ, because the Bible clearly says, "We will meet him in the air, and his feet will not touch the ground."
For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds, to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Thou shalt bring down the noise of strangers. The branch of the terrible ones shall be brought low. He will swallow up death in victory, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from off all faces, and the rebuke of his people shall he take away from off all the earth. For the Lord hath spoken it. And it shall be said in that day, Lo, this is our God, we have waited for him, and he will save us. This is the Lord, we have waited for him, we will be glad and rejoice in his salvation.
It is for us to determine today which side we will be found on in this great battle of Armageddon between God and Satan, between truth and error. There will be no neutral spectators. Each person will be found in one of two positions. They will either join the lawless in making void God's law, or will be among those faithful who live by every word of God and who keep all of his commandments.
How long halt ye between two opinions? If the Lord be God, follow him, but if Baal, then follow him.
So we need to be prepared, but in spite of what's coming, we need not be afraid, neither should we be afraid of the plagues.
Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. And I saw as it were a sea of glass mingled with fire, and them that had gotten the victory over the beast, and over his image, and over his mark, and over the number of his name, stand on the sea of glass, having the harps of God.
God will have his people on the sea of glass, those who escape the mark of the beast and the plagues. This can be you and I if we choose to follow God's word and not be deceived. You can see all studies relating to these issues of the last days on our website, www.sureword.co.uk. May God bless each one of us as we prepare our hearts and our lives for the soon coming of our Lord and for eternity.
Now, speaking of these Protestant expounders on the prophecies, the historicist expositors of the prophecies, and speaking also of the martyrs of history, and also of the reformers, Henry Grattan Guinness says, like the prophets of old, these holy men bore a double testimony a testimony for the truth of God, and a testimony against the apostasy of his professing people. A twofold testimony. One for the truth of God and against the apostate Church of Rome and her teachings, including especially Futurism. Futurism is a Roman Catholic teaching. It is an apostate teaching. It takes our eyes off the biblical, historical, and prophetic Antichrist, the Pope of Rome, and puts it on a future single individual. It's a lie, a Jesuit lie with a very specific purpose, and that is to destroy utterly Protestantism. And the evidence of the destruction of Protestantism becomes vividly apparent when you consider what Vatican Council II achieved. The capitulation of the Protestants and a return to the Roman Catholic Church, the Mother Church. The Protestant daughters are literally going back home to Mama. They find themselves at war with the truth, at war with the gospel, at war with prophecy, and at war with Christ. And unless they repent, only God knows the end. Renounce apostasy. Renounce futurism. Renounce Rome. And return to Christ, our only hope. The author continues, he says, the providential position which they occupied and the work they accomplished gave singular and special importance to their testimony. And this was their testimony, and nothing less, that papal Rome is the Babylon of prophecy, drunken with the blood of saints and martyrs, and that its head, the Roman Pontiff, is the predicted man of sin, or Antichrist. Do you see why I say that to call oneself a Protestant and to embrace futurism is incompatible? Do you see why I say those who call themselves Protestants and uphold the futurist interpretation of Bible prophecy have shamed their own face? Do you see why I say that those who embrace futurism and believe it to be the truth can hardly call themselves Protestant? They don't even know the meaning of the word protest, nor what the protest was all about. It was about protesting the apostasy of Latin Christianity. The very foundation of Protestantism is the knowledge, the unanswerable truth, that Romanism, its Pope and its Church together, fulfills the prophecies of Daniel, Paul, and John. And there's no other candidate. And here we find the Protestant churches even renouncing the name Protestant. They would rather call themselves the Emerging Church, or the Evangelical Church, or anything but Protestant. And why? Because they no longer protest. Just like Kenneth Copeland, the Babylonian babbler, he said the protest is over. Well, it's not over. It's just over for you. Now, our testimony is twofold, to defend the truth and to oppose error. Roman error to uphold the truth, Protestantism, historicism, and to condemn the scarlet harlot of Revelation chapter 17 and all of her harlot daughters. That's the twofold testimony of God's providential witnesses throughout history. Do you see why it just simply bounces off my forehead when people criticize me for not spending enough time talking about Jesus Christ and spending all of my time talking about Antichrist? Because to them, there's only one testimony. But in truth, there is a double testimony in true Bible-believing Protestantism for the truth of Christ and against his Antichrist. Now you take this Protestant country, has heard the gospel until even the heathen can recite it. Yet no one dares to lift a finger against Antichrist in the churches today. That's why I spend all my time talking about Antichrist, because no one else will. And I stand exonerated before an all-holy God for what I do here on Inquisition Update. This is his work, not mine. Now, to reject this twofold testimony of God's providential witnesses on a matter of such fundamental import, and to prefer to it the counter-doctrine advocated by the apostate persecuting Church of Rome, is the error and guilt of modern futurism. And that futurism is self-condemned. Futurism is literalism, and literalism in the interpretation of symbols is a denial of their symbolic character. It is an abuse and degradation of the prophetic word and a destruction of its influence. It substitutes the imaginary for the real, the grotesque and monstrous for the sober and reasonable. It quenches the precious light which has guided the saints for ages and kindles a wild, delusive marsh fire in its place. It obscures the wisdom of divine prophecy. It denies the true character of the days in which we live. And while it asserts the nearness of the advent of Christ in the power and glory of his kingdom, it at the same time destroys the only substantial foundation for the assertion, which is prophetic chronology, and the stage now reached in the fulfillment of the predictions of the apostasy. But in spite of the injurious effects of these false interpretations, quote, the foundation of God standeth sure, unquote. None can cancel the prophecies which he has written in his holy word, and none can deny or destroy the mighty and far-reaching results which their true interpretation has already accomplished in the world. It has given us, and this is its glory, it has given us the Protestant Reformation. It has broken the iron chains of superstition and despotism and lifted nations from the depths of their abasement. It has reared a temple whose walls no enemy can ruin. It has reopened, it has given back to the world that book whose teachings have led millions into the way of life and peace. And the sacred light of these prophecies is still guiding the Church of God across the wide ocean of her dangerous way. Those steadfast stars of prophecy, which lighted of old the persecuted Waldenses through the darkness of the Middle Ages, which lighted the progress of the Lollards and the Bohemians before the Protestant Reformation, which lighted the noble reformers through gloom and tempest 300 years ago, and which have since lighted watchful saints throughout troubled centuries, are shining still in that high and holy firmament, whence no mortal hand can pluck them down. And they shall shine on, those thousand glittering stars of prophecy, till they have fulfilled their glorious mission, till they have guided the church in safety to her celestial haven, and their long-enduring radiance melts at last in the rising splendors of eternal day. God has given us light. It came in the form of the Protestant Reformation. But we have refuted and repudiated even the very foundation of that Protestant Reformation, that truth which God delivered to us. Historicism, the historical interpretation of the prophecies, the reality, the knowledge that we once firmly grasped, both in mind and in spirit, that Romanism was the great apostasy, that the Roman Catholic Church was that woman, that scarlet-clad woman writing the Feast of Revelation chapter 17, and her head was the biblical, historical, and prophetic Antichrist, and that we ought to renounce her, mark her as doomed, and call God's people out of her. Instead, we wish to re-bed with her. What a hideous reality. And none of it would have been possible, none of it, had we not bought the Jesuit lie, hook, line, and sinker, futurism. The Pope is not Antichrist, he's a single individual at the end of time. You must make reparations now to the holy man of God in Rome, and you must rejoin the Roman Catholic Church, and eat and drink damnation to yourself in the form of the Mass. Another sacrifice, as though Christ's sacrifice wasn't enough. What blindness, what darkness has overcome the light in Protestant America. What shame. And to think that I believed that Jesuit lie for 50 years of my life is almost more than I can bear. I'm sure my listeners will forgive me for the severity that I have for those who remain in that error. Now we'll continue, if I can, Lecture 8 of this most magnificent Protestant work, Romanism and the Reformation from the Standpoint of Prophecy, by Henry Grattan Guinness. This lecture, Lecture 8, is entitled Double Foreview of the Protestant Reformation. Did you know God, you know, something as magnificent as the Protestant Reformation, which I've equated in the past has been the miraculous deliverance of God's people, the equivalent of which was the crossing of the Red Sea of the Israelitish slaves of Egypt. That was our deliverance. That was our Passover, the Protestant Reformation. With God's strong right hand, he delivered us from the bondage of Rome, from our modern-day Pharaoh, the Pope of Rome. Gentiles have experienced the same history as did the Jews before us, and we fail to recognize that deliverance. The Shekinah glory of God led us across that Red Sea, and he fed us with manna from on high. He gave us his law. He led us to the promised land. And now we want to reject all that and return to Egypt? God forbid! Double foreview of the Protestant Reformation in Scripture. Henry Grattan Guinness says, in our previous lectures, we have considered from the standpoint of prophecy the great papal system of Latin Christianity. And it now remains for us to show you in this closing lecture that the same mirror of the future which so fully reflected the coming Roman apostasy reflects as clearly that Reformation movement of the 16th century, which emancipated from it myriads of mankind. This could hardly be otherwise, as prophecy traces the entire story of Roman rule in both its pagan and papal forms, it carries it on to a point even now future. It would not, of course, pass by unnoticed the most remarkable and noteworthy incident of the latter section of its history. It could not omit from its anticipative record an episode so distinctly providential as that Protestant exodus. That Protestant exodus which split Western Christendom into two halves and severed from the communion of Rome, Norway, Sweden, Denmark, Germany, Holland, and Great Britain. It might well be omitted from Daniel's very distant foreview, but scarcely from the latter prophecy of John, when the incipient workings of the apostasy had already commenced. Neither the story of the apostate church nor of the true would be complete without it, for it was an episode of stupendous importance to the welfare of hundreds of millions of mankind through 9 or 10 generations, both to those whom it liberated from the superstitions and tyrannies of Rome, and to those on whom, by a counter movement, it riveted her fetters more strongly than ever. And by that counter-movement, he means the Council of Trent, the Jesuit-led Counter-Reformation Council of Trent, that damned every belief of Protestantism and demanded that the Protestants either return to Rome or be destroyed. He continues, what? Should the ruin wrought by Romanism be plainly portrayed in advance on the prophetic page, and the revival produced by the Spirit of God and the word of his mouth be left altogether out of view? Should the work of Satan, his corruption and defilement of the professing church, be reflected in the divine mirror and not the work of the glorious head of the true church, through his faithful witnesses in the restoration of the world of the primitive Christianity it had lost? Never! A true mirror reflects everything alike, and scripture prophecy anticipates the entire outline of Christian history. That's the definition of historicism, don't you know? Prophecy is a mirror of the future. A true mirror reflects everything alike, and scripture prophecy anticipates the entire outline of church history. Just as there were no events in the history of Israel which were not foretold before they came to pass, so in the history of the Christian church. The Reformation of the 16th century and its glad and glorious results are as clearly foreshadowed and foretold as the Romanism of the Dark Ages. You'll naturally inquire, where and how? Before replying, let me remind you that there are two kinds of prophecy in Scripture, the acted and the spoken or written, the type and the prediction. In the Levitical sacrifices, for instance, we have acted prophecies of the atonement. In Isaiah chapter 53, we have verbal predictions of it. The whole history of the natural Israel is typical of that of the spiritual Israel or the Christian church. Both are delivered from Egypt. Both are redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Both are led through a desert. Both are sustained by bread from heaven. Both journey toward a rest that remains for the people of God. This broad analogy descends in a wonderful way to details. The Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 10 shows this and states that not only was Israel's history typical, but that it was divinely ordered that it might be so. In other words, it was intentionally prophetic. Quote, "These things," he says, "happened unto them for ensamples and are written for our instruction," unquote. Not only are they recorded for our warning, but they occurred in the providence of God in order that they might foreshadow the experiences of the Christian church, and that she might learn from them solemn and needed lessons. The incidents of Jewish history actually happened, that they might be types of Christian history, and divine foreknowledge is as much exemplified in this correspondence between type and antitype as in that between prediction and fulfillment. I am to show you this evening, then, two sets of predictions of the Reformation. One acted in Jewish history, the other symbolized in apocalyptic prophecy. The one embodied in the story of the Old Testament, the other in the symbolic predictions of the New. Before I can do this, you must allow me to remind you with some degree of accuracy what the Reformation was as to its broad historical characteristics. It was not the formation of the church, but its reformation after its ruin by Romanism. It was not a first beginning, but a second. Pentecost formed the church. Popery deformed it. Protestantism reformed it. Pentecost occurred in the first century and is associated with the work of the apostles themselves. The Reformation did not occur till the 16th century and was not completed till the 17th, and is associated with such names as Luther and Calvin, Zwingli and Knox, Cranmer and Latimer.